So let us start our today's seminar. And our today's speaker is Dmitry Kipetkov, a researcher from Israeli Institute of Technology. Dmitry will give a talk about some unified approach to the density and density ratio estimation problems based on surface optimization techniques, whatever it is.
All right, so, okay, so thank you. Thank you. I'll start my presentation. First, thank you for inviting me for this talk. Thanks a lot. And one question, so before I'm beginning, as I saw, you usually like make a lot of discussions at each slide, you stopping and questioning and so on. If we will do it like this, I probably will not finish my presentation in 1 hour. So what I'm offering, like, let's keep the questions to the end of the presentation, and then I will answer all of them. Probably many of the questions that will arise, I will also answer them in next slide. So we'll probably get your answer anyway. And I will maybe have some 5 minutes pause in the middle. So I'll answer also the question of that. Is it okay?
Well, it's okay, but please allow us to ask questions if something isn't clear on the current slide, because sometimes
up to you, really. Like it was my suggestion, because I don't think like in this procedure we will finish this presentation. So, but it's up to you. I can answer also in the middle.
Okay, so guys, please try to abstain from questions until the end of the presentation or until I have slots for questions. But if something remains absolutely unclear on a given slide, then you may ask, because that's important. Because if we do not understand something in the beginning, and if we keep listening until the end before we ask questions, then we may just get lost. All so right. with this remark, let us start the talk.
Okay, and again, I think that many questions that will arise also will have this answered in the following slides. So, okay, so I will share the presentation now. Okay, everybody sees the file?
Yes.
Yes, right. So, hi, I will present my work, which is like all the summary of PhD research that I did in the last few years. The name is General Probabilistic Surface Optimization, and it's kind of a summarized and also extends theory about the probabilistic inference of different modalities like density functions and ratios, and also there are some strong relation to the optimization problem in about the indicator. We had like 2 weeks ago the talk of Evgeny, I think it was his name. So I will also touch this NTK kernel in this talk. Okay, so first the preliminaries, because you all know it, but still to get ourselves into the context, I will talk about the probability density functions, PDF. And so let's assign it as PUX. You hear the symbol just to symbolize one PDF. We inside several slides, we'll have two PDFs to work with. So we need somehow to differentiate between them. So we have PDF function defined over some Rn, and basically it represents some probability or frequency of ID samples appearing in various neighborhoods or areas of the main Rn. And for example, if we have this kind of columns distribution PDF defined on 2D dimension, if we are sampling this distribution, so we can see that the samples really follow this PDF function. And the knowledge of the PDF function is extremely useful in many machine learning problems. Likewise, density estimation problem, which is estimating this PU from samples, ID samples, XUI, it's basic, but also very challenging statistical estimation task. And I will talk about this problem, but not only, but it will be many different but similar problems in this context. So there are many solutions to this problem, approaches like MLE, NC, KD. We will touch them, some of them in the in few slides like in the future. And the basic idea behind many of them, if you look very deep inside them, you will see that they share this same idea with the histogram. So the idea is just to separate our RN space into bins, count in each bin how many samples we have, and let's say normalize it by total amount of samples. So this is like histogram, of course nobody does it for high dimension, but many of the approaches that I will also talk about, they share some common patterns with this algorithm. So if you look deep inside or into them, they will be very similar steps in algorithms. All right, so now I will define the problem that I'm trying to solve. Consider two densities, PU and PD. As I said, we have now two PDF functions, and U and D are symbols for some physical perspective of the optimization, which we will see later on. And consider two ID samples from each one of them. And now the question is what we want to do with these two data sets. So usually to analyze data, there are several different tasks that we would like to answer, to solve. First of all, as I said, density estimation, very important task. Conditional density, density, ratio estimation, divergence, and all of different statistical problems that we know it from machine learning domain. And it's important, for example, in robotics, computer science, economics, and et cetera. So for being more specific, if we estimate the PDF PU from its samples, it's very important for distribution entropy estimation or even image denoising. Estimating the ratio of two PDF functions from the samples, important for anomaly detection and also divergence learning. This is like all the GAN methods here coming into the play. Estimating these two target functions on a logarithmic scale, usually much more numerically stable. And even getting more abstract, we can describe each one of these objective functions that we would like to learn as this general form. So some function, some mapping T that gets first argument X and second argument this ratio. And well, for different T's, you will get like these four target functions or many others. So it's like we can formulate the problem of inference as some T that I would like to learn with these two arguments. And again, there are many different papers, so many probabilistic methods that solve this inference problem for different T's, like I know thousands of them out there. And we will talk about how to solve it all in one simple approach. So the related work is going to be the following. So again, our task is to take our model, deep learning or RKGS or any other function class, function space, to enforce it to approximate some target function that we are defining in our particular data analysis problem. Many frameworks exist to solve this problem. For example, Breakman divergence-based methods, F-divergence like F-GAN. Probably some of you know this framework. Many objective functions were created to perform optimization so that our model will approximate the corresponding statistical modality, maximum likelihood estimators that are based on KL divergence, noise contrast estimators, energy-based cost critics, losses of guns, and many other. They are really, there's no end to papers that go in and talking about how to estimate this different functions. All right, so my goal over this talk and also my research is to understand, we have a rain here, so. All right, so to understand more deeper understanding of all the probabilistic modeling, how different approaches are related to each other, what is the common, what is the shared algorithm behind them. Also, to produce new estimation methods to infer some target function t, and make it easy and intuitive. So maybe we can emphasize this last point to make it really easy and intuitive, which we see in a physical perspective of the optimization. And of course, use deeper models, applying neural networks for learning different probabilistic modalities, understand gradient-based optimization. So all these points were a part of this research, and the contributions that are coming from this work are following. So they will be introduced probabilistic surface optimization (PSO). This estimation framework will allow us to create infinitely many objective functions to learn almost any t. So it's includes all the ratios and all the PDF functions, but not only. It will give us systematic and simple theory behind the asynchronous learning, allow us mechanically recover many existing and also create novel statistical objective functions. And of course, we will talk about the deep model. So relation of this PSO framework to the neural tangent kernel. And in the end, I will talk about NTK and talk about its dynamics during the typical optimization. All right. So straightforward, I will define the algorithm that the main lines of this algorithm, of this framework. So what we will see is following. We'll take some function space that has this signature here. So from R and to R to scalar, and can be neural networks, RKHS, or whatever you would like to use. And I'm looking on this function parameterized by theta as some geometrical object drawn here. So it's like a high dimensional surface, flexible surface that will push in some way at any point of this support of the surface. So here, this is like 2D support. It can be Rn, of course. So at any point of this surface, the height of the surface is the output of this function. So basically, we will look at function as some representation of this high dimensional surface. And the outline of what we will see is the following. We will create two physical forces that are applied in up and down direction. And we'll see how we can control them, how we can create forces such that our model will converge to any desired t. So this is the main outline. We will see in a few slides what are these forces, why it's actually very similar to this picture of physical forces. And we will see it in a few slides. Right. And more formally, consider again two PDF functions, PU and PD, or RN. Let's assume also that they have analytical support. It's not mandatory, but there are some specifics of what happens outside of this mutual support. And consider two IED samples from each one of them. Now, the following step is to choose two magnitude functions. We'll see why I call them magnitude functions. So MU and MD that have this signature here. So they have both get two arguments, RN and scalar, and return the scalar. These two functions, I'm emphasizing it will be our choice that will affect our convergence in the end, like what target function we will approximate eventually. And I also will talk how we can choose them. But some minor conditions should be satisfied with these two functions. You can find the specifics in the paper, but they are not really strong ones. So basically, many choices here can be okay. Following this, consider the gradient descent algorithm, the usual one, the most simple one that we know, where we update our theta, our parameter vector of neural networks of RKHS, not really matters, in this following way, where here we have this learning rate and d theta has this form here. So important parts of this update are following. We see here two averages over ID samples from PU and from PD. signs are important. So here's minus and here's plus. Yes, and we'll talk about different components of this update later on. So the entire estimation framework is very simple. Just perform gradient descent, usual, and not really anything special about this algorithm. The d theta is what I showed before, and my claim is following. At the end of the optimization is, if everything is good, we get to the global minima, etc., etc., this equilibrium will be satisfied. So PU multiplied by MU is equal to PD multiplied by MD at every point of X, of the mutual domain, basically. And we will see how, why, and how can we use it to estimate different statistical modalities. This equilibrium is quite important and useful. All right, and to derive this method, we can do the following simple steps. So let's define this functional here, the objective of PSO objective function, where we have here two expected values, or PU and PD, and this MU tilde and MD tilde are antiderivatives of MU and MD. So they are antiderivatives of our previously chosen magnitude functions. And we don't really need to know them. So we can use magnitude functions even without analytically known antiderivatives. Just for formulation is important, but in any point of this algorithm, you will not need to know this tilde functions. So given this functional, the Euler Lagrange equation of this functional simply will show that F star, that minimizing this functional, will satisfy this equation. So this is the equilibrium that we saw before. So again, this is just the variational equilibrium of the corresponding loss that defined over the populations or respective values. And the idea is just to, let's find this minimum, let's find this F star. Because again, later on, we will use this equilibrium for different statistical problems. So to find this F star, we just solve the optimization. We just take our loss and find the function that minimizes it. So we choose some function space, usually it's neural networks. And we solve this problem optimization. What I'm doing usually, it's like gradient-based optimization. It's very common. So the gradient of this loss with respect to theta is shown here. We again can identify two magnitude functions, MU and MD, and they are part of the variational equilibrium that will affect the variational equilibrium. And these two model gradients, they define basically the metric over function space, and going into all the talk about the NTK and the kernel. This is very important object of function space. We will get into details later. And PSO framework basically approximates this gradient with this sample approximation. Okay, so detail that we saw before, I just perform the gradient descent with respect to this population gradient, the loss gradient, but I only approximate. Okay, so a few words about the balance state that comes from this optimization, PU, MU equal to PD, MD. So the choice of MU and MD controls the convergence of F star. So we will see how can we use this to estimate different modalities. Knowledge of antiderivatives again is not required at any point of this algorithm. And even if you like want to know a different generalization and representation errors, how they are related to the loss, even there you will see that most of the notions are dependent on the magnitudes and not on antiderivatives. So antiderivatives really not that important. It can be used for different statistical modalities, as I said, and magnitude again must satisfy some minor sufficient conditions and not that strong. You can find more details in the paper. Okay, so now we will talk about the physical system, which is probably the most important part of this work, because it will allow you to estimate anything without even knowing the mass or statistics. This kind of sounds not that good, but anyway, this is really what helps you to use this framework without a lot of knowledge, of mathematical knowledge, and going in following way. So consider the model, and as I said, it's just a representation of this high dimensional geometric object. And if examples for function space can be neural networks, we connected CNN, ResNet, etc., or RKHS, which is just linear model in some feature space. And there is also the corresponding deposition kernel that is just dot product of these features. So important part of any function space in the context of gradient descent is this model kernel we find here. So we have model gradient at point X, model gradient at point X tag, and then the product. So this is responsible for many things: interpolation, interpolation during gradient descent, also known as NTK. 2 weeks ago we saw it, but in different context. And in RKHS, importantly, this NTK actually it depends on theta, right? So it's changes in neural networks during the optimization. But in if you work with RKHS functions, then it's just equal to your reproducing kernel and just constant during the optimization. So this is basically the main difference between neural networks and RKHS. That this kernel is constant or adapting in some way. Okay, and to understand what this kernel does and why it's important, let's consider the following simple update. So let's take our parameter vector theta and just add to it this model gradient at some point x in input space. So it can be shown that at any other point x star, the function or this surface will change according to this first Taylor approximation. Basically, this is the kernel, the model kernel, the NTK. We can think about this picture as a following. We push at some point X, or optimize push, and our model, our surface at any other point X tag changes according to the kernel approximator, first Taylor approximation. And intuitively, we can think that we have some stick or bond of some shape that we are pushing at point X up or down, depending on sign here. And the shape of this stick is just described by this kernel. So this actually, this description in some way details of the sticks that we have. So any function space that you choosing before your optimization is basically comes with the stack of these sticks that you use later on in optimization. So again, when you push at some point, you can think that you do it with some sort of stick, and we know kind of kernels that are usually used in kernel methods like RBF kernel or Laplacian kernel. And you already can even think about what happens if I have like this kernel here, more wide or more narrow, what will be influenced on my surface. And like usually like the narrow one will give you a more local effect on your model, on your surface. And the straightforward question from this, can we use these wands, these sticks, to sculpt our surface, to move it to any desired shape? And basically, this was the original thinking when I invented this piece of framework. So let's look again on update that was introduced before, our d theta. It's the way we change our theta vector at any point of gradient descent. So we see here the linear combination of these model gradients, right? So each one is just push at some point. So we have kind of pushing surface at points xui, and these pushes are up because of minus here. And we, in the same way, we are pushing our surface down at point xdi and down because of plus here. So u and d basically are the this relation to the direction of the force that is applied. And when we're pushing at u, at samples u, we are magnifying our push or our force by the output of magnitude function mu. And this is why it's called magnitude. And same goes for md. And again, the model kernel, the NTK of these parts, the corresponding parts of the gradient and the model gradients, they are just sort of some kind of sculpture tool that we use during this optimization. So we can kind of coming from a priori chosen tools, the tool set that we use in the entire optimization. Right, so if we are taking few simple limits that we can talk about some pointwise optimization here. So if we'll take like asymptotic large data sets, so we have infinitely many data sets, and the bandwise of this kernel, if it goes to zero, so basically it will say us that the surface is infinitely flexible, then we can see this entire physical system as following. So at any point, like pointwise, at any point x, we have two forces that are applied, up and down. Force up defined as magnitude, as product of PU and MU, like MU, like larger MU, you stronger push it up, and larger PU, you have more samples from PU. So because of this frequency, you have more stronger force up. So basically this frequency component and analytical component are product of them is the force, and same goes for the down force. So this yields the dynamic system. And of course, in such dynamic system, the all the optimization will stop when two forces are equal at each point. So fu equal to fd. And if we're looking at this definition here, it's basically this variational equilibrium that I showed before. So again, if you are looking at this in this way, in this physical system way, you kind of don't need really to understand the variation of the calculus of variations and etc. Not so good, but still, you can use this intuition that will basically allow you to understand the optimization and to create the novel objective functions we'll see. But here is important remark that it's really only variation equilibrium. So at an infinity of infinitely many data points and infinitely flexible function space, we will get it. But actually, we are really far from that point. Like the real gradient set equilibrium will strongly depend on the properties of the kernel and on the amount of the data, of course. All right, so the following part is I will talk how can we use the variational equilibrium for you for different estimation problems. But before, if you have questions, I can maybe answer them now.
We are looking for examples of all this function, M, etc.
Okay.
And I have a question concerning magnitude function. Do I understand right that if second argument becomes too large or too small, then magnitude goes to zero?
If what comes up into small again?
Second argument in magnitude function.
Second magnitude?
Second argument. Argument.
Second argument. So what about the second argument here?
So let's consider, say, MD. So this is the magnitude of downforce.
Okay.
If our F theta, that is the second argument, becomes too small, too low, or too far from zero, then this magnitude will go to zero.
Well, this is actually an important question, man. Like, first of all, the answer is that depends on the losses. So there are different losses that are existing. Many of them the what it happens really is actually different. Like if f theta, like for mu, for example, if f theta at some point x is going too much up, like some the haze at point x is very, very high, mu will go to zero. So it's like there are some balance in these algorithms that you will see that you cannot too much overfit. You will overfit in special cases, but these magnitudes are made in such way that it's more harder to overfit. So mu again will go to zero in many losses, like for example NCE or cross entropy. It will go to zero if f theta gets higher and higher, and it's similar, but the opposite relation will be in MD. So if f theta will go down, like lower and lower, MD will also turn to be zero. It's related to the boundedness of magnitude functions. I will, I have some slide about it. So if magnitudes are bounded functions, they usually have this property.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of improves the stability and reduces overfitting. So there are less numerical optimization problems during such optimizations, but it's not exactly prevents the overfitting. You still can overfit with such methods.
Yes, I understand that I can still overfit. The motivation of my question was that otherwise, if we omit this property, I'm not sure whether we are able to reach the equilibrium, where the equilibrium exists.
Well, it depends. Now, there are several equilibriums. So one equilibrium is variational, like a perfect system, which is never happens. And the other would be a finite sample size. The thing is that there are many magnitude functions like mu and md that are not changing. For example, if we are talking about FGAN framework with all the critics that it provides you to create, mu there is constant one. And still it's converging. And the answer is like, okay, in variational equilibrium, it converges because of these forces. But in the real practical case, it converges only because of your kernel has niceness. So basically NTK, if it's not, if it will not have a, not have a niceness, it will or overfit for bounded functions, or will just diverge for functions like if it's constant and not depend on the second argument.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
Okay. Okay, so let's talk about this variational equilibrium and how can we really use it for different estimation tasks. So I will start with a few simple examples so you can see the intuition behind it. So let's take mu being equal to one, as I mentioned before. There are magnitude functions just equal to some constant. Okay, so mu is equal to one and md equal to the second argument, just output the second argument. This is these magnitudes are related to some already known objective function that called ULO sieve. And let's see how it will affect our convergence. So we will just take these definitions and we'll put them into PSO Palm state, this equilibrium that I showed before. And this equilibrium can be also shown like if we move some part different sides, it's just PU divided by PD equal to MD divided by MU. So this is like the same equilibrium. So if we are putting these definitions here inside, we will see that F star is equal to this ratio. So basically, we got ourselves a new method that just takes the samples, two data sets, and will eventually return you the ratio of these PDF functions. And of course, it's only variational, so there are still many problems on our way because of dimensionality, etc. But still, like, this is like all the methods are working. Like variational equilibrium is very well defined, but practical, it's you don't really know how close you are, especially in neural networks. But anyway, we'll talk about it later on. Okay, so another example. Let's take this definition as follows. So mu now is not constant. It depends on its first argument and just returns pdx. and MD is the same as before. So the setting I need to explain a little bit before I'm talking about it. Setting is following. You have a PU and samples from it. So PU you don't know, but ID sets from it you do know. And PD is some axial distribution that you are choosing. So it's kind of a noise contrast estimation setting, more or less. So you are choosing this PD, so you take a uniform or Gaussian, you know how to sample it, you have infinitely many samples from it, you know it's analytically this PDI function, so you can use it also when you define your magnitude functions. When we use this definition, this new definition, and solve Pissot balanced state, we'll see that F star is equal to PUX. So we basically gather ourselves this estimation solver. I call it once DPDF for no reason, really. And what I want to show you actually, this intuition that before we had like one MFX, and now we just change a little bit MU to have this PDX, and we move from a ratio estimation to the estimation. So they are really, all these methods are really well related. So if you see this connection, they're all practically the same, even though there are some papers on them still. So let's see the demo. Let's see some small example. We have, again, we will use it as our PU. This is, will be our uniform PD on some two-dimensional domain. Again, PU we don't know, but we have ID samples from it. PD we do know it's uniform here, and we have samples also from that. And our task is to move our F theta to have a shape like this. So wait, I will share it. Share this video. Okay, so this is some neural network, I said like 5 layers maybe fully connected, and undergoes this optimization. So you can see that they are kind of pushes up and down, some thermodynamics happening there, very similar to the physical system that I explained before. And the thing is that you need a little bit decay and learn rate slowly, because it's stochastic and it's kind of a jumping around the target function. There's like some distance to the target function and jumps up and down like center from it. So if you are like decaying learning rate slowly, this vibration becomes smaller, and eventually we will get your estimation. Okay, so. Okay, so this is a small example, but again, they are really very similar in this manner. There's, you change only one of these magnitude functions, and most of this framework stays the same. So you can also, in this way, compare different losses, what how they are related. Maybe even create new losses. And for creating new losses, you need to know the following. Following definitions. So more generally, we can think about this framework as following. So we have here two mappings that are important. So R, will define R as just a ratio of MD and MU. So our chosen magnitude functions and their ratio will be this R. And C, as I already mentioned before, it will represent our target function that we would like to learn. So it's per task. Like data analyst will define this function that he will want to learn. And it comes from his desire. And F star will be equal to this T eventually. So we have these two definitions, R and T. An important step here is to understand that they are actually inverse functions. So they are inverse with respect to the second argument. Here I'm writing what is inverse function for you, someone that forgot what it is. Given this relation, we can create now estimators for any t in two simple steps. So we are defining our t that we would like to learn that corresponds to this estimation of ratio to whatever we want. And there are two steps actually. First, we need to find the inverse of t with respect to second argument. And small remark here, usually it's really simple step because the usual objective function that we are like to, we want to estimate, they are really, it's easy, it's really easy to inverse them. And there are also, for lazy people, there are also online calculators for inverse functions. So like I used it the most in my PhD. So this is not really a problem. So you find from T the R, and then you can take any two magnitudes whose the ratio is equal to R, and it will work for, like it will produce your convergence. So again, there are small letters here that MU and MD should satisfy some minor conditions, but they are really minor. Okay, so example. Let's create new estimators for log PUX. So instead of this estimation, we do log test estimation. Our T that describes this particular target function is right in here. So TX, Z, here we have X, here we have Z. If we are replacing Z by PUPD, we will get basically this log PUX. So this mapping TXC can be easily inverted, and its inverse will be just right in here, S and again PDX. So here is this the first step of inversion. Then we can use any MU and MD that will equal to this ratio. So we take again MD and MU with first argument X and second argument, it's our model. And we will just put here this expression here. And again, second argument is just the model. So we put it here. And any two magnitude functions that satisfy this will give us the convergence. So for example, you can take MD equal to this XF and MU equal to PD. And it will be one option. But actually, you have infinitely many different options. And this is kind of interesting because, well, now you have a way to create infinitely many estimators for any target function. So to summarize the relation between these two functions, R and T, they are 1:1. So this magnitude ratio R and T are inverse. So knowing one, you can recover the other. Likewise, this magnitude pair MU and MD and R related as one to many because they are really infinitely many magnitudes that will give you the same R. And for this reason, you have infinitely many different PSO instances, magnitude pairs that will give you the same convergence. So the straightforward question is which one should we choose? And unfortunately, I don't know the answer. Really, this is kind of embarrassing because I was working with this method for a long time and I still didn't answer this question. But one property is really important, and as we already mentioned before, this is boundedness of magnitudes. So consider any two magnitude functions MU and MD that have some convergence T. We can, even if they are not bounded, like they can have a very large output or very small, we can create the new pair as following here, right in these two steps. And these two new MU and MD will be bounded because of the structure of this transformation. And they will also have the same convergence because the ratio doesn't change. Like these two denominators cancel out. So again, these two new magnitude functions have the same convergence, but they are bounded. And bounded magnitude usually much more numerically stable during the optimization. They have this property that if you are pushing too much up and too much down, so these magnitudes become closer and closer to zero. Also, it's you can find many theorems about generalization that the, these theorems in like empirical risk minimization, they are depend on the Lipschitzness of our GT function. And the Lipschitzness or Lipschitz constant of PSO loss is actually this, its derivative, this is this magnitude functions. So if we are bounding magnitude functions, we're kind of enforcing our objective function to be Lipschitz. Likewise, we can use here other norms. So here, like it's absolute value, but we can raise it in different powers and so on. And interestingly, many of the popular objective functions have this kind of form. So they have bounded magnitudes. So noise contrast estimation, logistic loss, cross entropy, they have all this boundedness property. And maybe it's why they're so popular, because like in any problem, you have infinitely many objective functions. It's very well known in classification, actually, that there are papers that give you different frameworks how to create different objective functions for classification. And still, many of people still work with cross entropy. Maybe the reason is because they have this property of boundedness. And again, experimentally, you can see quite simply that bounded functions, bounded magnitude functions, give you more stable optimization. Like if they are not bounded, you will get all these problems of nonce during the neural network optimization, especially when two densities are not very well aligned. Okay, so summary so far. We saw one simple algorithm to infer many different objective functions. It's intuitive, all this physical system perspective, and its force equilibrium very easy, surprisingly easy. It allows us to recover almost all the existing objective functions for this estimation, but not only. It also allows to recover statistical divergences of different types, cross entropy, losses of critics in GANs are also this form. Conditional density estimation also possible by applying Bayes' theorem. Okay, so this is a summary so far for a variational perspective. We can use it, this variational perspective, to create new statistical objective functions. And the next part, I will talk about the NTK and about the actual optimization outcome. So before that, if you have any questions.
Yes, the question is about the theoretical convergence property. Can we directly state the corresponding theorem and say about some required properties of these magnitude functions, what property it should have in order to have a quick convergence or low convergence, something related to Lipschitz constants or to something?
Okay, so this is it's not a part of my work. Like there are, if we are talking about generalization error, for example, so there are many works about the empirical risk minimization, and they are quite general there. So you can apply them also for these objective functions. So it goes into direction of Rademacher complexity, etc. And I think it's like this topic is still not answered. Like I only recently started to work with this research offline to understand how can you bind generalization of errors, but what I saw currently, I don't think it's final work on this topic. So it's still in development, of course, for neural networks. About theorems, you can derive theorems for variational equilibrium. So variational equilibrium it's kind of a equilibrium that you will get in infinity of data and infinitely flexible neural networks, but even then, not any two magnitude functions will work because you need your your laws to be convex or quasi-convex. So what I derive, it actually makes it quasi-convex. You can find the theorems about these properties. So again, it will ensure this, the population loss is, well, it's minimum well-defined. Currently, the theorem that I provide, they are of sufficient type. So I say that such and such properties, for example, like positiveness of magnitude function on specific domain, will be enough to ensure that the variation of equilibrium is well-defined. Again, the population loss has its well-defined minima, but I think it's too much, even now it's like too much conditions there, like it's too strong, sufficient and necessary conditions, like inferential theorem and convex conjugacy, say, you know, they are like necessary, sufficient and necessary theorems. I think my conditions over magnitude functions are not that far, but still something can be reduced. But saying this again, all the conditions there that I'm demanding, they are not that strong and not hard to satisfy.
Okay, but can we say that if, for example, in some low-dimensional case, we are using not a gradient descent equilibrium, but instead some second-order optimization methods, we do not almost depend on the properties of these magnitude functions?
Well, if you are doing the second order, like for example, well, again, that part of my research, I didn't never deal with it, except for some courses, but also with neural networks, you usually don't do it. But saying that, second order will require you to know the Hessian of loss. Hessian of loss, if you are calculating it, it will involve the same magnitude functions and some Jacobian and also derivatives of these magnitude functions. So if you are write the Hessian of any objective function of PSO kind, you will see that still there are properties that will affect your optimization. M and the magnitudes and their derivatives will affect different properties of your algorithm. But saying that, again, I think you are talking about the idea that if we are performing a second order instead of first order, we'll get different convergence. So it's not true because, again, from calculus variations, we have the same well-defined optima, and it's not really, this optima is not defined by a gradient or Hessian of the loss. It's actually defined by functional derivative of the loss. What really will be changed, all the generalization properties and the bias properties of the algorithm, but the global minima that we are will never reach it, but still the variational minima will not change. It will be the same.
Yeah, this is for sure, but we are interested in the speed of convergence and not just the guarantee that we have some required equilibrium.
Okay, about the speed, again, I think there are several works on this. I wasn't analyzing this in my research, but what I know, I can tell you that it's very well defined by the kernel, by its eigenvalue decay. So if we are looking about the optimizations, there are kind of movements in different eigenvectors of the kernel, and the speed of movement there is defined by the eigenvalue itself, or it's some ratio with a Lorentz rate. So if you have a large eigenvalue in that direction, we will go faster, and the opposite also correct. So if you have all of eigenvalues large, this kind of will give you also the metric that I'm talking about in a few slides. So it will give you a metric on function space that tells you that in every direction you can walk as easily as you want. So then I think you can like derive very fast algorithms. But again, it's only part of what I am starting to research. So I cannot, I don't want to it tells something that is wrong. Like, this is my my partial knowledge of this topic.
So there are no evident methods, like use some consideration about these eigenvectors or something in order to choose a better possible magnitude functions. It's not clear how to do this in practice.
Good point.
Isn't it?
That's a good point. Actually, it's a good thing that you mentioned, because actually I also was thinking one of these ideas is that now that we have infinitely many options for magnitude, which one we choose, then maybe we can learn it or in some way learn the objective function itself. And then you need to really to see how these magnitude specific magnitude functions are aligned with any particular kernel. And it's future work. So the idea that I'm still trying to understand if there are easy solutions here.
Dima, wait a minute. You mentioned that there's an infinite amount of magnitudes which correspond to the same objective, right?
Yeah.
Because we're only interested in the ratio of the magnitudes. But do I understand right that if we change one magnitude to equivalent magnitudes, by equivalent I mean that they correspond to the same objective, then in our optimization procedure, the only thing that changes is learning rate.
No, of course not. It's not only learning rate. There are different, not really, because these are not linear functions, right? This multi functions can be quite complex by themselves. I think maybe if they are like, they are would be constant and you would change what constants they are, then it would be correct, but they are much more than this.
Uh-huh. Okay, but does it mean that if we change our magnitudes to equivalent ones, then we are in some sense we change how our learning rate will change? Something like this.
We kind of change the landscape of loss. So yes. If we are would draw the losses, like I think I showed you in the interview. That if you are taking different magnitude function, but for the second order, you change the landscape. So some losses will have like more symmetric, some less symmetric, some will have more flattened areas, but their minima will be still the same.
Uh-huh. Okay, I got it. Yeah. So this is a kind of we can see it as a kind of a preconditioning.
Yes. So. Like I'm kind of you have your choice for choosing kernel, but now you also can choose the magnitudes. So it's both choices will do sometimes good and sometimes bad. And the question is when. So this is the main problem to understand.
Okay, thanks. Let's proceed.
Okay. All right, so let's talk about the real gradients and behavior, or almost real enough, something I will still not talk about. So the variational equilibrium is very useful, we saw it, but actually we have the gradient descent behavior. So we do perform some specific algorithm and the data is finite, it's not infinite. And the question is how close we are getting really to this variational equilibrium. And this goes into the direction of how close we are to the global minimum, so global population minimum. So basically, we all know that it's a very hard problem in deep learning. We are nowhere close to answer this question. But okay, this is a real issue. Okay, we have different function spaces here, different magnitudes, how they are working with each other, how this generalization error happens. So again, about generalization error, we kind of know some theorems with Rademacher theory, Rademacher complexity, etc. Again, I don't think it's like final word. There are still some stuff to need to be done. But so I will not talk about generalization error, but I will talk about the representation. So what I mean by representation error is even if we are having infinitely many data, so we still take this asymptotic regime of many data points. and still perform the gradient descent, as we saw according to equations, what will we get? Will we get the variation equilibrium or not? And for this, we can consider this following dynamics. I think something very similar we saw 2 weeks ago, but then the dynamics were in continuous time, but well, optimization gradient descent is discrete time. So you can show that our function goes through this dynamics here, this approximation, because first order approximation still. And this is, there's several components here. So first of all, this part here, it's just the functional derivative that is defined here. So basically it's functional derivative of our loss, and it's just a vector to the steepest direction of like a reduction of our loss or opposite of it. So it's, we can think about it as some infinitely dimensional vector in some Hilbert space. So here is this scene, the direction. GT is the integral operator of this following form. So taking function, we just convoluted with this NTK at time t. And basically we can think about it also here and also here, it's like matrix vector product. So we have here infinitely a large matrix GT and infinitely long vector in some Hilbert space. So this is the dynamics that can be shown. And the question is how NTK, how gradient descent affect our solution. So before, the variation equilibrium would be saying that our functional derivative is equal to zero. So this part is equal to zero, and it's just the equilibrium piece of that we saw before. But actually now we are stopping this dynamics when this matrix vector product is equal to zero. So basically we are allowed for functional derivative to be in null space of this kernel. And it's not something that not happens. It's actually really, really practical scene that you almost never will get to your variation equilibrium, because usually this functional derivative will get to the null space. Like G usually has some null space. Then our functional derivative is just zero along all the eigenfunctions that have eigenvalues non-zero and not zero, or like has initial value, its projection at the bottom eigenfunction. So it produces a bias into our optimization. And the thing is that it will produce the bias only if our direction to our global minima is spanned by the eigenfunctions that belong to zero eigenvalues. But if it's not, then we kind of okay. We can, like, again, G just give us some direction in function space where we can walk and where we cannot walk, or where we can walk, but very, very slowly. So even with millions of iterations, you will not even get any movement in such direction. And again, if our global minima aligned well with the top eigenfunction, then we are still okay. All right, so some summary of role of gradient descent operator, this GT here, it's metric over function space. It's eigenvalues, eigenfunctions define well, in which direction it's easy to go, in which it's slow. Alignment between the functional derivative and eigenfunction of large eigenvalues decides the optimization outcome. Again, kind of like miss here generalization part, but it's still like it will be true for large data sets, but something very similar happens also for small data sets. So I think it's also true there. Okay, and also it's very well known, like kernel alignment methods are very well known in kernel machine literature. So there are many works that take, for example, some linear combination of existing kernels and try to learn this combination, like to learn a new kernel that is well aligned, for example, with labels in regression task. So it's, there are several works on this, and there's like a kernel alignment metric for this kind of works. And surprisingly, neural networks does it during the optimization. So this is the last part of this talk, how NTK changes and what it actually does. All right, so here I will do, take some a simple experiment. But before that, I will remind you that most of the literature about NTK, at least at its beginning, was talking about the constant kernel and some limits, but still they were talking about some kernel that doesn't change along the optimization, which is very, very far from the reality. So let's consider the following experiment. We have some target function F star. I chose this Mona Lisa here. So it's has a two-dimensional X, and Y is just the grayscale of the picture. And we learn it with a neural network. Several layers fully connected to neural network. So the usual regression task, nothing special here. We take 10,000 samples. We perform least squares optimization for very long time. And the goal is to investigate how the NTK that depends on time changes, how its eigenvalues changes, and how the eigenfunction of course change along the gradient optimization. So straightforward to the conclusions, we can see that at time zero, these eigenfunctions of this kernel, they look like just rays of light. I think it's very similar to the expression that were derived for NTK, for this limit NTK. So the limit NTK things also have these eigenfunctions. So at time zero, it seems to be correct, but only after several thousand of iterations, we see that these eigenfunctions are really, really close to the Gramscians, so to the function that we are learning. Mona Lisa. Here I use the Leakey loop fully connected neural network with six layers. Some very useful notion to know about the kernels and this kernel specifically, that of course we have the frequency that getting higher with the index. So we can see that the higher eigen functions have very noisy nature. Okay, and also, we can see how this kernel looks around the different points. So I'm just showing this kernel where X is just this red plus, and X star is just any point in input space. So just drawing this kernel around specific points. And again, at time zero, there's nothing special about this kernel. So there's some local behavior, so it's like higher around the point, more or less. But other than this, nothing really special here. And after several thousands of iterations, we can see again that it gets very close to the function that we are learning. And again, there is this local behavior, so we can talk also about bandwidth of these kernels, etc. Okay, so the outcome of this experiment is that top eigenfunctions aligned with the F star, and this improve the speed of the conversion that we were talking about before within F towards the F star. And maybe this is why neural networks are so good, only suggest here. Intuitively, we can think about, we can see this nature as following. So we have this surface, high dimensional surface, and when we shape it, we push it with our stick, the stick itself changed its form. So it's kind of aligns to the surface that we're pushing. And neural networks with more layers have higher alignment, which may explain their performance priority. And the same behavior was observed also for L2. We saw losses in optimization like SGD, ADAM. Well, it's quite a uniform behavior. And also, I think I saw some paper that talking, and now it's like more popular to talk about this alignment. I think it's called like NTK rich regime or something, but there are more papers that are starting to talk about it. And some paper was talking about relating it to the compression of neural networks. So there are this compression of representations layer by layer that some people usually talk, and some other people related and disaligned, saying it's just the same same behavior. All right, so let's conclude this talk. The framework PSO allows us to learn any function T. A strong intuition, all the forces, and PSO force allows us to create a lot of different objective functions to solve different applications. We can actually extend it beyond like just two forces. We can create like three forces, four forces, etc., etc. The same principle will be satisfied. Actually, I used it in one of the applications for occupancy mapping in robotics, where there were three forces that I needed to use, and still works the same. Like all the principles are not changing. The actual equilibrium very strongly depends on the properties of model kernel. In neural networks, this kernel aligns with the target function, currently unknown reasons. And the future work, well, there are many questions, like which PSO instance should we use, what is optimized, what is stability, how all this, what is it, the interplay with the kernel, how the optimality of one PSO instance depends on the properties of the kernel, what are the convergence rates, generalization error. So I do know that there are like bandwidths of this kernel that changes with number of layers, and it's actually affect the overfitting or underfitting behavior. But I still very in the start of this, in answering this kind of questions. And once we know the interplay of PSO and the kernel, like we would know at some point what are the most optimal properties of kernel to have, the next question would be very, very important, is to how can we control this property? So how can I create now new neural network architecture such that this kernel will have such and such eigenvalue decay and such eigenfunctions? Well, also we need to think about how to regularize these models better, because currently it is so very, very strongly overfit in the high dimensional set. So here are some papers that I mentioned, and well, thank you. Any questions?
Thanks, Dmitry. I have a question, but probably I will ask it in Russian. Я немножко уже одуревший. Все-таки много материала. Значит, вопрос такой. Давайте к Монолизе вернемся.
К чему вернемся?
К Монолизе.
Монолизе, окей. Да.
Там, где ты собственные функции рисовал.
Окей.
Следующий слайд. Да.
Это уже кернер, да.
Так, нет, здесь кернер, а предыдущий слайд. Там, где, собственно,
это эйгенфункции, а это уже кернели.
Правильно. Ну вот я про эйгенфункции говорю.
Окей.
Значит, смотри, что будет происходить, если, допустим, мы нашу нейросетку обучали и загнали ее в узкий минимум? Я правильно понимаю, что там у нас эти вот собственные функции будут выглядеть совсем не так красиво?
Я, в принципе, не знаю. Я никогда не сравнивал, что происходит. Что значит узкий минимум? Давай пытаемся понять. Узкий минимум может быть, не знаю, но, наверное, когда эйгенвалюс там очень маленький. В любом направлении у тебя... Хотя нет, это уже...
А эйгенвалюс могут быть и большие. Там кажется, гипотеза рабочая, что собственные функции, eigenfunctions, будут либо очень хаотичные, либо какие-то очень точечные. То есть они не будут таких вот регионов покрывать на картинке.
Смотри, еще раз. Важно тут понять, что каждый лосс, когда мы делаем оптимизацию, когда мы смотрим, как градиенты выглядят, то там есть две компоненты. Есть это модули градиенты и есть эти магнитуды. То есть это в любой лосс так существует. То есть а градиенты, они нам дают какие-то фичеры parameter space, или feature space, и magnitude, эти коэффициенты. То есть вся работа делается на magnitude. Когда мы идем и подходим к минимуму, когда уже там оптимизация останавливается, это обычно потому, что magnitudes идут в null space к Kerber.
Так.
Окей. Вопрос сейчас пытаюсь понять, что ты тут в этой всей картинке спрашиваешь. Потому что как бы движение у нас есть в любом направлении в theta space. Просто в некоторых движение уже намного, очень маленькое, потому что мы уже на эквилибриуме там, а некоторые, допустим, там связанные с маленькими эгенвалиями, там еще у нас движение есть, потому что мы как бы очень медленно продвигаемся к нашему оптимуму, но движение настолько медленное, что даже его и не заметишь.
Нет, это я понимаю. Пока вот то, что ты сейчас сказал. Но я спросил немножко про другое. Okay. Я просто пытаюсь понять, можно ли с помощью вот этих вот собственных функций как-то пытаться оценивать широту минимума, а значит и обобщающую способность. И мне кажется, мы бы умелым экспериментом загнать нейросетку в узкий минимум принудительно, но можно это сделать, если цель задаться, и посмотреть, что там будет происходить у нас с собственными функциями, ну и с NTKM, который там получился. Он же как бы зависит от точки пространства весов, в которой ты находишься.
Вопрос, что такое узкие и широкие? Потому что ты как бы ваша группа идет там в weight space, вы там в этом в основном занимаетесь. Для меня узкие или широкие ничего не означает. Так что объясни, что ты имеешь в виду под этим? Там Jacobian Lossa, он большой, маленький, что именно под этим подразумевается?
Ну, я скорее имею в виду большую кривизну Гессиана, или большую кривизну матрицы Фишера, что почти эквивалентно.
Окей.
Я понимаю, что ты говоришь про функциональное пространство, а я пытаюсь про weight space говорить, потому что, во-первых, мне это ближе, у меня интуиция есть какая-то, а во-вторых, я хочу как раз связать эти две вещи. Потому что weight space, мы понимаем, ситуация, когда у нас плохой generalization, это ситуация узких минимумов. Я пытаюсь понять, какой будет эквивалент функциональных пространств. Чтобы мы могли поглядеть, допустим, вот на собственные функции и сказать, о, у нас нейросетка переобучилась, у нас вот плохие собственные функции. Вот сейчас мы можем глядеть на кривизну white space. А если она высокая, то мы можем говорить, ну, наверное, у нас будет не очень хорошее обобщение.
Ну, мне надо подумать насчет этого. Но как, я думаю, у меня есть что-то очень похожее, чтобы ответить на твой вопрос. Да, я сейчас сделаю share другой вещи. Возможно, кривизна там будет тоже. Одну секунду.
Так. То есть, условно говоря, логика моего дизайна тренда какая? Надо загнать, то есть принудительно симулировать ситуацию, когда у нас плохое обобщение, и посмотреть, что изменилось.
Да, но как бы я, еще раз, как бы я в другой линии ресерча, поэтому я меньше думал на такие вопросы. Но у меня, может быть, будет что-то связанное, так что подожди секунду, я открою это. Окей, ладно. Смотрим, что здесь из этого выйдет. Так. Окей. Во-первых, все statistical consistency и etc. это уже как бы известные вещи. И когда обычно у нас есть какая-то параметрик модель, то можно доказать на асимптотик нормальности на нее. Допустим, что-то вроде вот такого, что если у нас есть какой-то theta star, и у нас есть estimator, который зависит от data size, то он идет к какому-то normal distribution. Я думаю, что вот его covariance обычно во всех этих теоремах, это как бы известные теоремы, я просто их переписал из других бумаг, которые уже сделали. Это, так вот этот covariance это для PSO, который я вывел. И возможно, еще раз, как бы я меньше занимался этим weight space, Но если это тот же самый covariance, который ты имеешь в виду, как бы curvature, то тогда у нас есть вот такая вот матрица, очень здоровенная, очень красивая, но и она, кстати, превращается в information matrix, если мы делаем MLE, KL, и все такое. Но как бы в general форме она как бы не сокращается. То есть здесь есть какой-то Hessian, здесь какой-то Jacobian, и в MLE они сокращаются друг друга. Здесь оно не сокращается. Сейчас посмотрим, что каждый имеет внутри. Окей, значит, Hessian – это вот эта вот форма, где вот эта вещь какая-то дуальная вещь NTK. То есть NTK у нас был dot product вот этих двух вещей, правильно? Если ты их перевернешь, делаешь cross product, то это уже что-то связано с information matrix. Да. И тогда можно показать, что Hessian выглядит вот в такой форме. Ну, еще раз, как бы здесь уже более затруднительная вещь происходит. Тут есть derivative magnitude functions. И я не знаю, как бы, если, как бы, как можно ответить легко на такой вопрос, потому что здесь, как ты видишь, в most general form этого PSO objective function. Он...
Нет, окей. Я понимаю, что я не прошу ответа на такой общий вопрос. У меня, скорее, интерес был чуть более эмпирический, а именно посмотреть, вот, допустим, на том же эксперименте с Мона Лизой. Если мы возьмем сеть, которая сильно переобучилась. Uh-huh. Для меня сильно переобучилась, потому что узкий минимум свалился. Это не обязательно. Можно как-то иначе переобучить. То есть у которой низкая будет генерализация. И посмотреть, что будет происходить с соответствующим кернелом и что будет происходить с собственными функциями. То есть как они будут выглядеть. Раз у тебя такая чудесная штука, что ты можешь визуализировать на своей этой модели задачи.
Во-первых, ответ, как, наверное, многие ответы прислали, дам. Хороший вопрос, я не знаю. Но если ты как бы делаешь учение и уменьшаешь немножко Леверенхайт, так что в конце он такой очень слабенький, вот этот спектр, он не очень изменяется. Он как бы, когда начинаешь чуть-чуть уменьшать Леверенхайт, там уже в середине оптимизации, когда он уже такой не сильный, ты можешь увидеть, что вот этот спектр, вот эти эгенфункшнс, они примерно такие же. То есть там есть какая-то регион, там, допустим, 20 тысяч итераций, когда это все происходит, а потом оно уже более-менее одинаковое. Поэтому, я думаю, может быть, то, что ты имеешь в виду, это более связано с eigenfunctions, eigenvalues. Eigenvalues растут обычно. И, может быть, в каком-то смысле мы говорим про eigenvalue decay, потому что если мы говорим про kernel methods, то там eigenvalue decay, он обычно связан с генерализацией. Но еще раз, как бы это только какие-то догадки.
Mm-hmm. Ну окей, хорошо, я как бы тоже еще подумаю. Потому что мне кажется, что попытка анализа нерести через kernel, через собственные функции может неожиданно какую-то нам дополнительную интуицию пролить на наши пляски с бубном вокруг узких и широких минимумов.
Я думаю, все это связано каким-то образом, как бы надо просто подумать действительно на все эти связи, потому что как бы weight space – это просто feature space нашего учения. So, как обычно в kernel methods у нас, мы можем объяснить нашу оптимизацию каким-то через kernel-ами, какой-то function space или через дуальную картинку в feature space. Так что эти две картинки, они обычно говорят об одном и том же явлении, просто иногда одну легче понять, чем другую.
Правильно.
Это наверняка есть.
Именно поэтому хочется связь понять, чтобы у нас появился дополнительный инструмент, что если нам сложно, допустим, в weight space работать, то мы пытаемся, как вижу, с дуальной стороны подойти и взглянуть на то же самое, но вот по-другому. И наоборот. Но это как бы надо думать. То есть я задал вопрос, он такой сложный, и поэтому я ответ-то не прошу, а скорее надеюсь тебя немножко заинтересовать. Может, тебе тоже будет интересно, и ты там попробуешь чем-то сделать. Окей.
Я подумаю насчет этого вопроса.
Спасибо. Да, Colleagues, any more questions? Ну, кажется, не я один немножечко одурел. Не потому что плохое выступление, выступление клевое, а потому что много материала. Это при том, что я это тоже второй раз слушаю. Поэтому, видишь, мне проще. У меня еще какие-то силы остались. Большое тебе спасибо. Дим, значит, мы на связи остаемся уже, правильно?
Да.
То есть, если чего, у нас какие вопросы будут, к тебе можно обращаться.
You are welcome, как говорится.
Спасибо, спасибо. Так, коллеги, тогда на этом мы сегодня семинар заканчиваем. Как раз ровно полтора часа уложились. И на следующем семинаре у нас выступит Надежда Чиркова, которая расскажет про то, как она применяла новейшие методы NLP к задаче анализа исходных кодов. Уже такой будет чуть более прикладный доклад. На этом всем спасибо.
Все, до свидания.
Счастливо.